Welcome back to TSO Daily Dose. Today, I'm very happy to be sitting down with the bass player from the Violent Femmes, Brian Ritchie, who also happens to be the music curator at Mona. Thanks for coming in, Brian.
Whenever I can be of service to the TSO, sign me up.
We've done a number of collaborations. When I say we, the orchestra's done a number of collaborations over the year. I only joined at the beginning of 2017. And the first performance I was meant to do was with the Femmes. And then I got called up the week before I was meant to start, and they said, actually, we've only written it for two trombones because we weren't sure what was happening. So I got to sit in the audience and watch you. It was a great performance.
I'm glad you enjoyed the performance, but we'll have to talk to the arranger.
Do you know the arranger well? Is he familiar to these premises?
Well, Tim Jones, principal trombone for the
tuba. My next door neighbor.
Yeah, for the TSO. He was one of the first musicians I played with when I moved to Tasmania.
Yeah, right.
Yeah, I had a gig at 10 Days on the Island.
Uh-huh.
And put together a band, you know, relatively spontaneously, which Don Bate, your
I
guess one of your former colleagues or predecessors, was in the band. Tim and Conrad Park, the drummer.
Yeah, wow.
And that was my first band in Tasmania.
That's cool.
So I go back a long way with Tim, and we have a lot of mutual respect. I support his projects.
Yeah.
He's always been willing to come up. He's even toured with the Femmes.
Yeah.
Yeah, he's toured in our horn section, the Horns of Dilemma.
Tim's one of those, he's a real dark horse, I think. You know, he turns up and he does his job incredibly well, but then he has this amazing other career with playing for people like you and arranging for you guys.
He's well respected in the jazz field as well.
Yeah.
And we just reprised that show with the Hollywood Bowl Orchestra.
Yeah, that's right.
And the conductor of the orchestra himself is a tuba player. So he said, these are the best charts I've ever worked with a pop group. And I'm so proud that a tuba player wrote these charts.
That's awesome.
Yeah.
And we're so lucky that TSO got to premiere them before the Hollywood Bowl. Tim was in your first band that you set up here in Tassie. Because last night, as I was doing a bit of research, I came across your album, your Shakuhachi, Jazz Shakuhachi album. Was it New York City Shakuhachi Club? Is that right?
That's right.
Yeah.
And there's tuba all over that as well.
Yeah, and it sounds great. I was so disappointed that I had not discovered it until now. What drew you to Shakuhachi and that sort of setting for it?
It was a circuitous route to get to that point. I'm really into jazz. It's my favorite music. Although I am a rock musician, my favorite music to listen to is jazz. And I was always fascinated with the horn players, mainly the saxophone players, trombones, trumpet. And I wanted to get into that, and I started trying to learn the saxophone, and then I just realized, this isn't going to happen. You know, I didn't have the discipline to devote myself to it to get to the level I would have liked to have been at. I just moved to New York and kind of had I had free time because I was new to town and just meeting people. And they had a flute convention in Times Square. So I went down there, and it was a world flutes convention. So not only the silver flutes that we're so familiar with, but also flutes from all over the world.
Yeah.
And I encountered the Shakuhachi. So I pick it up and start playing it a little bit, and then someone handed me a business card.
Yeah.
If you want to learn how to play that thing, give me a call. And I was like, learn how to play me? Because I'm self-taught. I'm a self-taught musician.
Yeah.
I never needed lessons. But then I thought, well, why not? I've got nothing better to do. So I started taking Shakuhachi lessons. And the reason why I was interested in that instrument was because I was already practicing Buddhism. I was practicing meditation, sitting meditation.
Okay.
And the Shakuhachi is called Suizen, blowing meditation.
Yeah, that's right.
So I knew that it was associated with meditation, and it was a meditation tool in the Japanese tradition. And I thought, okay, I'm a musician and I'm a meditator. Maybe this is going to work. And in fact, it did. It was like what I was looking for, but didn't realize it. And being able to create that sound is itself addictive. Because it's a very Some people say it's a healing sound or it's a calming sound. I mean, there's a lot of force and energy there too.
Yeah.
It's calm energy.
The album with the tuba, is that meditative to you? So that's, to me, quite jazzy. But, like, do you ever use the shakuhachi for meditation or is it always?
Yeah, it's, well, I'm a licensed teacher.
Oh, really?
Because you have to get a license. It's not like in the West where anybody, you just have to keep one lesson ahead of your student. You have to get a license. It's like black belt in karate. So okay. I'm a licensed teacher. And I know a huge repertoire of traditional meditation pieces and other Japanese music, like folk music,
yeah.
And the ensemble music, which is more like classical music. Yeah. It's secular. But then I could not help but be drawn into playing the shakuhachi in other contexts.
Yeah.
Originally, I thought, I'm just going to be a rock musician, punk rock, whatever, and I'll be a traditional shakuhachi player. But then one of my friends who's a jazz bass player, and actually he's also a published author of meditation books, Alan Anderson. He just won a prize for his latest book.
Wow.
He was running something called Acoustic Christmas, and he said, hey, can you play that shakuhachi, and can you play Christmas songs on it? And I thought, what? But, you know, it was a charity event, so I thought, okay, I'll give this a go. And I did Green Sleeves, which, anyway, John Coltrane did a beautiful version. There are several good jazz versions of that. So I kind of based it on that, and then I realized that it was also a very good jazz instrument, blues instrument, and other kinds of Western. I can play Irish music on it. It's not fully chromatic like a Western flute.
It's a minor pentatonic scale.
It's a minor pentatonic scale, so you use a different length for whatever keys you're in.
Uh huh. Okay.
Like harmonicas.
Yeah.
Once I started playing jazz on it, then of course, you know, I couldn't unremember what I had done and just launched into that.
I think it's really interesting, this dichotomy between, you know, being a very experienced Zen sitter and being a rock musician, because they don't seem to, in most people's minds, go together very well. Do you use that to influence your curation of Monophoma, this sort of pulling between the calmness and the craziness of what I imagine a rock lifestyle might be sometimes?
Monophoma is a music-based festival, and it was originally a project of an art museum. So my curation of that is what's good for music, what kind of music actually should a museum be presenting, you know, which would be not ultra-commercial music, and trying to create for the whole body of music. I don't use any demographic. I'm not looking to get like 24 to 35 year olds or what. It's for everybody.
Yeah.
And also trying to mix those people together. Like what we had with the TSO and Violent Femmes was very interesting, because I was walking down the street twice, and we'll call them old ladies because they're older than me and I'm old, so they must be old, came up to me and said, we never really heard your band before, but we went because we liked the TSO. And you were terrific. And I'm like, wow. You know, so it's, you know, getting, using these kind of collaborations to get people to listen outside of their comfort zone, listen to stuff that they wouldn't normally listen to. That's basically what the festival's about.
It started in Hobart. Have you been with Monophoma from the beginning? How long has that been?
Yeah, I started the festival along with Salamanca Arts Center.
Mm-hmm.
And Mona. So I was independent at that time, and then gradually I was forced by the ATO to become an employee of Mona because, well, that's a long story.
I've heard David Walsh has a long history with the ATO.
And they said, who's this guy that you're always with, and why is he not on the payroll?
Yeah.
So that's how come I became an employee, which is good because I really love working at Mona.
Yeah, what's it like working at Mona?
We have so much talent on our staff and dedication, but you'd be amazed how many musicians and artists are on the staff. And it's great that we're able to you know, have this framework where they can work for us, and then they have time and some support to do what they want to do artistically, including myself. So it's a great team.
Yeah,
I really love it.
Have you ever sort of, in your curatorial role, had an idea and thought, oh, this will never work, and you take it to David, and he goes, yeah, let's do it?
That's happened several times. Monofoma itself, it was just the idea, let's do a music festival. We met in September of 2008, and the first festival was in January of 2009.
Yeah.
So there wouldn't have been very many people with the faith and vision to see something like that through in just a few months.
Yeah. Oh, it's amazing. And, you know, for me, a new resident to Tasmania, it's one of these things that when you decide to move to this beautiful, small little town at the end of the world, you go, oh, but we have this amazing museum and this amazing music festival and all these other things that can make it seem really exciting. So,
yeah, hopefully we can reopen soon and get things back on track.
I've only recently found out you've done a couple of Corona concerts, or many Corona concerts, live streamed.
It started out randomly. I was up in Wynyard, and my friend has this beautiful silo, like that, which was empty, and it had great acoustics. So I broadcast a live concert, and this was right before the lockdown. But we could see that the lockdown was impending. So I just called it Corona Concert. I didn't even think about it. It's just like a Facebook Live thing. And then we drove back to Hobart. So the first one was in Wynyard. And then after that, I started doing them every day from Hobart or in surrounds, because people were responding so favorably to it. And then once the lockdown came in, it was like, okay, I'm stuck at home, and there are no other musicians here, and I'm not even supposed to see anybody else. So I'm not going to let this stop me from making music. And then that's what the Corona concerts were meant to be, like a defiance of some outside circumstance trying to stop me from doing my normal job.
It's nice that you've sort of found a way. It's sort of, you know, the TSO has had to find a way, and we've ended up with this format, and we're, you know, getting in here and performing as well. But so it's nice that it's a common theme amongst musicians at the time. You look, we're all finding a way to do what we love and to share it with other people. On that, can we talk about the performance you're going to give us today on the Shakuhachi? Back to the Shakuhachi. What are you going to perform, and why have you chosen that piece?
Well, that's a good question, because I was asking myself, what should I play for these people? What should I play for the TSO? And I've decided to go with a song that's very multifaceted and even has a lot of different origin points. So it's the Largo from the New World Symphony by Dvorak. But the reason why I want to do it is because it also became an American song.
Yeah, that's right.
I believe it was the black gospel musicians, but also the white gospel musicians do this song, and it's called Going Home.
Mm.
So it ties in with Dvorak's longing for the, you know, for his homeland. But in the gospel tradition, it's like going home means, because the black people obviously had incredibly rough life.
Yeah.
And the song was like a song of hope that, okay, this life is not good, but we will be going home. There's a beautiful melody, and I thought it was really interesting that it comes out of the symphonic repertoire. And it sounds good on the Shakuhachi, and it will also give the TSO listeners opportunity to compare, like, the sound, what the sound of the Shakuhachi is compared to standard woodwinds like you see in an orchestra with keys and mechanisms. The Shakuhachi is just a piece of bamboo with five holes in it and a wedge at the top that you blow into. So it's very simple in design, but it's an expressive instrument. So I'll start out with a little bit of traditional Japanese style playing so that they can hear what it sounds like in its natural element, and then I'll go into the New World Symphony.
Thank you so much for coming in today and talking to us.
It's been a pleasure, and we have to get out on the bridge with our
horns. Yeah, no, I'm looking forward
to practice it. Long tones.
Yeah, we see who can hold the
breath. I practice it on my balcony. Some of the Corona concerts, I'm just practicing long tones while I'm walking back and forth on the balcony.
Do you have people say,
that music, what is this song? And I'm like, long tones.
The Doppler effect really helps with that, you know, as you're moving back and forth. Once again, thank you for coming and joining us today.
My pleasure.
We hope you enjoy Brian Ritchie's performance on the Shakuhachi.